And he was very young, in his teen. And he was a little bit mischievous, and he did some tactics or techniques to have monopoly on his teachers. So he would bring with him dates and assign some of his friends to turn away any child or any kid wants to come to learn, so he'd have the teacher all day long for himself only. Also, he used to do services to the teachers. At that time, his teacher, two of them were almost blind. He would take them to the masjid and back as help. Also, he would wait in the sun or at the door of their teacher just to ask a question. So he was up to learning full speed. His sister was worried about him because he spent so much time in the sun and so much time waiting for his teacher. And she talked to her dad, and her dad told him, "Don't worry, daughter, my son is learning the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam." He spent 7 years totally dedicated to one teacher, who is Rabia, whom we know him nowadays with Rabia al-Ra'i. He was a very great brain and very knowledgeable sheikh. Beside Rabia al-Ra'i, he spent another 8 years under another teacher, whose name was Abdullah ibn Hurmuz. He's also from the Mawali. And you notice that every Sahabi had a servant who became a master in education and teacher, became alim himself and faqih himself. And this is how the integration happened between the slaves and the masters. They adopted them, they became part of the family, they excelled, they surpassed their previous masters. And with the morals of Islam and where everyone is equal, even those of Quraysh, like the Khulafa, Bani Umayyah, they would not have any problem sitting down in the masjid, learning from those mawali, like Ata ibn Abi Rabah and so on. And we see that every great of the Sahaba who dedicated their life for learning and education, you know, not all the Sahaba spend that much time in learning and education. And this is, they're applying the ayah al-Qur'aniyah, فَلَوْلَا نَفَرَ مِنْ كُلِّ فِرْقَةٍ مِنْهُمْ طَائِفَةٌ لِيَتَفَقَّهُ فِي الدِّينِ وَلِيُنذِرُوا قَوْمَهُمْ إِذَا رَجَعُوا إِلَيْهِمْ. So you don't need the whole city to be fuqaha. There's other jobs to be done. So of the great Sahaba who dedicated their lives to the service of Islam, Qur'an, Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, comes at the top of the list, Anas ibn Malik, the servant of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who spent over 80 years in educating people about Islam and hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His servant, or his mawla, who became himself as a great scholar, is Muhammad ibn Sirin, and we talked about him. And he was a big source of knowledge for the Ummah, the following generation. Abdullah ibn Umar ibn al-Khattab, he had also a mawla. His name was Nafi', Nafi' mawla ibn Umar. He himself became one of the greatest of the fuqaha And as a matter of fact, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz dispatched him to go to Egypt to teach Islam. We have Abu Huraira, radiallahu anhu, who we know that is of those who narrated the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, comes in the first place. His student, his mawla, was this person, Abdullah ibn Hurmuz, who is the second teacher of Imam Malik ibn Anas. Abdullah ibn Abbas had a servant or a mawla who became himself a great teacher, Ikrima, mawla ibn Abbas. He's one of the best who knows the Quran and the interpretation of the Quran. And so on. So those great mawalis who were servants or were belong to those great figures themselves took the place of their teachers at the masjid and at educating people. Abdullah ibn Hurmuz taught Imam Malik for 8 years, but his friendship with him after he graduated continued for 30 years. And whenever Imam Malik mentioned that this is how I was taught by the knowledgeable people of the city of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he means those two teachers, Rabi'at al-Ra'i and Ibn Hurmuz. The third teacher for Imam Malik was the Mawla, another Mawla, his name is Nafi' al-Daylami, and he is, as we have mentioned, learned under Abdullah ibn Umar. Imam Malik ibn Anas has learned under Nafi', and we know from previous talks that the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is narrated by Imam Shafi'i, he heard it, he learned it from Imam Malik, he heard it, he learned it from Imam Nafi', Mawla ibn Umar, who heard it and learned it from Abdullah ibn Umar, who heard it and learned it from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This chain of sanad or narration is called the golden chain. And this is the highest level of strength in the narration, in the sanad of the hadith. You know, every hadith has a sanad and a text. Okay, so the sanad is the chain of men or women sometimes, like Aisha and so on, who narrated the hadith. We know every individual. We know him by name, by the time they were born and died, the way they lived, their character, their morals. You know everything about them. Like nowadays, when you Google somebody, when you Google those guys, you know everything about them. And we have the knowledge of close to 1 million people from that period in books called Ilm al-Jarh wa al-Ta'dil, where everyone knows his strength in narration and so on. This is something very important because you want to make sure that what we have received is authentic and this has been said by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we have been ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do or not to do. The fourth teacher for Malik ibn Anas was Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri. Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, he is one of the great tabi'een, and we have studied him also. And we have mentioned he was one of the great figures who were entrusted by Khalifa Umar ibn Abdul Aziz I was one of the first who wrote down and categorized and collected the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As a matter of fact, I came through a statement by Ibn al-Qayyim, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. He has mentioned that Imam Zuhri was the first and before Abu Hanifa in writing fiqh al-sharia in a book or in the order we know it now. We remember when we studied Abu Hanifa, we have mentioned that he is the first one who made this arrangements in the books of the sharia, starting from the tahara or the way to other subjects. Ibn al-Qayyim has said that Imam Zuhri had a fatawa which his student Muhammad ibn Nuh had collected in three big volumes, and it was categorized or in order of the fiqh which we know now. So, but this is something, number one, it's one of the opinion. Number two, we don't have a textbook which is carried there, so it could be have been lost or been taught and distributed in other books. It's like discovering America. Who discovered America? Columbus. But there's tens of theories that there's other people who came here, but which is the most popular is Columbus. So we know Abu Hanifa was the first who put the book of fiqh. He was born in the year 50 and died in the year like 124 or so. The fifth teacher of Imam Malik, we have mentioned Rabi'at al-Ra'i, the number one, Ibn Hurmuz, number two, Nafi', number three, Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, number four, and the fifth one is Ja'far al-Sadiq. May Allah be pleased with him. And he was also a teacher and a friend of Abu Hanifa, as you remember. And he was a great scholar, and many of our ahadith came through him, through the Imam. Nine of his ahadith been mentioned in Al-Muwatta by Imam Malik. And Imam Ja'far, he is a grandchild not only of Ali ibn Abi Talib, he was a grandchild twice from Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, from his mother's side. And he would say, وَلَدَنِي أَبُو بَكْرٍ مَرَّتَيْنِ. Abu Bakr has put birth to me through heritage, through ancestry, twice. And his fiqh was based on the Sahaba and not different from the fiqh we know. And he did not believe in many of the things which other people believe in. He was very wise. He had a lot of beautiful saying we need to remember or to read. One of it, which I liked so much, when we come to the issue of qada and qadar and predestiny, and I'm not praying because God, if he wants me to pray, I would pray, you know, all these things. He put it eloquently in very simple words. He said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى أَرَادَ بِنَا شَيْئًا وَأَرَادَ مِنَّا شَيْئًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had destined for us something and wanted from us something. فَمَا أَرَادَ أَرَادَهُ بِنَا طَوَاهُ عَنَّا. What he destined us for, he made it unseen, unknown to us. وَمَا أَرَادَهُ مِنَّا أَظْهَرَهُ لَنَا. What he wanted from us, he showed it to us. So why we keep ourselves busy with things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destined for us and leave the things he wanted us to do? In simple language, the issue of qada and issue of the unseen and predestiny and all of these are in Allah's knowledge and is of no concern.